Tahoe Community Church, if we could all rise, we're going to find out if we're washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Scriptures and some other things we have, and to light our Advent candles each week. So if you're interested in doing that, please let me know and we'll get you scheduled. We have 4 weeks of Advent. We can use 4 different individuals or 4 different families, wherever the Lord leads. So that'd be really great to get some different people up here to do that for us. So activities in the back. We have, this is ongoing activity, the Tahoe Community Church. We actually made these up to the trek retreat. We passed them out. Hard as we know, this is up to date with all the different things that are happening in the church. So you might want to grab one of those. You know what's going on. There's information on the Kingsbury Huddle. There's information on the Teen Huddle, which is what we're calling our youth group now. They're no longer meeting on Sunday nights. They're meeting on every other Thursday in conjunction with the Kingsbury Huddle. If that confuses you, just take one of these and you'll be all straight back. Women's event has changed quite a bit. If you got a flyer last week, you can throw it away. This is new and improved. So Jan, you have something to add to that?
I do. I just want to say that we wanted to change it up this year. And so we are changing it up. We're still doing the outreach to live violence free. So bring your small, I just ran across the road here. Anyways, bring your small luxury comfort items. And then the Live Violence Free human advocate and the one who runs the place, the chairman, whatever she's called, are coming to the event. And so they're going to be available to ask questions and learn more about Live Violence Free. Because it doesn't only involve, perfect, it doesn't just involve women, it also involves men. Anyways, okay, so the first thing is, we have small comfort items. There's a basket out there that we are gathering them in. Then you're to bring 2 dozen cookies, and that's it. Don't bring any food or drinks or anything like that, because our elders have graciously helped us cover the food. And Jen Patterson is going to be doing our food. Mm. So we're going to have, it starts at 12 o'clock. The ending is going to be around 2. I can't guarantee 2 o'clock. I can't guarantee 1:45 or 2:15. Because it depends on what the advocates and how many questions we have, because they're going to be at the end of the event. And Wendy Petty and I are going to be doing a little mini retreat on comfort, joy, and rest. And so I said everything, right?
I think so.
Oh, babysitting's available. I need to have you RSVP, adults, and if you need babysitting. All right, that's it.
Everything she just said is also on the events page on the website.
Yay!
You're like, what is all that? It's on the events page. You can look there too.
And the last announcement is, this is a preview of coming attractions. We're starting a new club in January. It's called the STEM ID Club, which is science, technology, engineering, art, and math by intelligent design. It's for children in first through sixth grade. It's kind of like what we did with Awesome Kids. We finally had them get off the school bus here, and then we have them until I believe 5:30 or so, and we'll be teaching them all these subjects, but from a godly point of view. So that'd be really great. If you have any children in grades 1 through 6, please talk to Wendy, and she'll get you hooked up what's going on with that, because it sounds exciting. So let's continue with our worship, shall we? So, inspiration for our opening song, Are You Washed in the Blood, comes from Revelation 7:13-17. Then one of the elders asked me, these are the white robes, who are they? And where did they come from? I answered, sir, you know. And he said, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed your robes and made them white as snow in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat on them, nor scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear in their eyes. That's encouraging news. Let us pray together. Father God, we so look forward to the time we will be before your throne in heaven, and we will serve you day and night. Thank you, O Lord, for providing a way to forgive us of our sins through the blood of the Lamb, through the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray that everyone here accepts the offer of salvation, and that our robes will be made white as snow in the blood of the Lamb. We ask you, Father God, to be with us during this time of worship, and that we would be drawn closer to the throne. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everyone, please stand. This next song is, we don't do a lot of songs like this where the words just repeat and repeat and repeat. And But this one we're going to do today, and I want you guys, you're going to know it better and better as you go. So I just want you to get louder and more obnoxious towards me. Okay? Like, we'll just have some fun with it today. Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Forever. Your promise still stands.
This is the time in our service where we dedicate our offerings to the Lord. For those that are visiting with us, we are not passing offering plates right now. But if you would like to contribute to God's work in this place, in our community, there's a place in the back of a container. You can drop your offering in there. We'll make sure it gets to the right place. But for our main prayer today, we're going to dedicate and pray for all these shoeboxes. This is a record, by the way, for our church. Seems like every year, more and more. Yesterday, all of us that were here in a couple of different shifts, we did 280 boxes. Took us about, 2.5 hours? The 2.5 hours was really just the very, very tip of the iceberg. Kind of give you an idea, Karen's already ordered stuff for next year. I'm not kidding. She'll be getting things all year long. She's really thrifty, gets things on sale, and my shed is full, my garage is full, underneath the church is full and stuff. Just really surprised how much stuff it takes to fill 280 boxes. That's a lot of stuff. So our goal for the year was 350, and we have 355. And it's 450 tomorrow for the Classical Conversations. So the number is going to go up. So that's wonderful. So now we are going to pray for all these boxes. They've already been prayed for a lot. We prayed every time we did one group, about 60 or so, we stopped. And now we watched a video about the boxes, and we prayed for the boxes. And so now we're going to pray for all of the boxes. So let's all pray together, shall we? Dear Lord, it's amazing to think that you know who will receive each one of these boxes. We have heard many stories how recipients of shoeboxes have received boxes containing exactly the items that they needed. We pray that each of these boxes meets the needs of those who will receive them. These boxes contain not only fun and useful items, but also they will contain the gospel in their own language. Most importantly, they contain the love of Jesus Christ. Recipients may not know who sent the boxes to them, but they will know that they are loved by those who pack the boxes and that Jesus loves them. We pray that the recipients will hear the message of Christ, will believe it in their hearts, will confess it with their mouths, and they shall be saved. And we pray that those who accept Christ will spread the good news to their families and throughout their communities. We thank you, Lord, for all those who packed these boxes, those who brought boxes in on their own, and for those who helped put all the boxes together. We also thank you, Lord, for those who will be going through these boxes before they're shipped, and finally those who get the privilege of delivering them around the world. We pray that through this effort, your name will be glorified, and the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, will be spread. It is in Jesus' holy name that we pray. Amen. And we have some children today. We're going to release the children. We're going to meet your teachers. We ask the parents to bring your children back to get them signed in. And the teachers will take them to our newly renovated zone downstairs. And while we're doing that, our privilege to have Corbett Robinson come up, pastor from Sierra Community Church.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What do you think the most said thing into a microphone is for all time?
Test.
Is this on? Test is probably right there too. Happy Sunday.
Yeah.
Hey, look, guys, this is what a privilege to gather and freedom and to get to discuss the Word of God, to share, to be a community of people that gets to do things like this. And send shoeboxes that come out of the grace that God has shared with each one of us and the desire to share that grace, and literally that word means gift, to other people. And so thanks for being a church community that takes seriously what it means to share the grace and mercy that God has given you with other people, people that you may never ever meet, people that we will get to see one day in God's kingdom in glory. And won't that be amazing?
Amen.
I tell you what, we have, my family has sponsored a few young children in Colombia, and I will likely never meet them in person, but I hope that one day I will get to meet them in God's kingdom, and I truly look forward to that. Now, it is truly a privilege to be here this morning and get to share in God's word with you guys. I'm excited for what we have to talk about. We're going to be in the book of John, as you can see back there. Now, I understand that it was not too long ago that you guys went through the book of John with Mondo. Yep. So you're like, here we go again. You know, I think that, you know, one of the beautiful things about the word of God, first of all, is it is multifaceted, multi-layered, and we could spend hours and hours and hours talking about a very small section of scripture and still being able to come out with new nuance to it. I'm not going to do that to you today, keep you for too many hours, but I do hope that as Dan and Noah and I work through the book of John, that the Holy Spirit will give you a new angle, or maybe a different perspective into some of the stories that Mondo has already walked you through. There's no, you know, I had a good friend of mine who struggled in a lot of areas in life. And so I would continue to move him back to the Word of God and say, what are you reading right now in the scriptures that's helping you to process this? And he told me, I already read the Bible. I'm good. And that's not how it works. See, that it is something that feeds us daily. And as we're going to look at today, one of the things that the Holy Spirit does is actively brings regeneration, newness, and creation into our lives. Now, as we're looking at the book of John, this is one of the four Gospels, the four biographies of Jesus, and it's unique in respect to the other three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We refer to as the synoptic Gospels because they follow a very similar pattern of stories. And although they have a different emphasis in each one of them, they follow a very similar path, and you'll find the same stories repeated through almost each one of them. The book of John, however, stands apart. And John is very specific in his purpose and how he has put his letter together. As a matter of fact, at the very end of his book, in chapter 20, he gives us, and this is just great. We don't get this in so many of the letters that we read. But John gives us his purpose statement. In chapter 20, verse 30 and 31, he says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. Think about that. All of the things that Jesus did that we have no record of. It just boggles my mind and curiosity to think of the different interactions that Jesus had with people that we don't know about. But these, the one that John has recorded, are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Savior, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. And so every time you open the book of John, this should be the lens to which you interpret everything that John is telling you. Everything that John is doing, we're going to look at the framework of his book, is moving us in this direction. It's not randomly put together stories. Each one of them is moving us in this direction of helping us to have life in our Savior by believing that he is the Son God. And so he begins, John does, in the very first chapter with a very famous introduction. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now that should automatically, and if you guys haven't figured this out yet, for I know I'm only over here once a month or so, but I'm very keen at what I like to call linking the stories together. So when I hear something like this and I say, you know what, I've heard that before, I follow that link. Because that's what John is doing. That's what the biblical authors are doing. They're connecting us to other stories. And then we start to see the similarities and the themes. And so when we read this, the very beginning, in the beginning was the Word, that takes us all the way back to the very beginning. In Genesis chapter 1, which says, "In the beginning, God." So John right away is connecting Jesus as being one with the God that is described in Genesis chapter 1. The God over creation, which we'll see here a little bit further. In chapters 2 through 10, this is what we call the miracle chapters, or the signs chapters. These are where Jesus is performing miracles. He's working around, he's healing people. And, you know, John uses this word signs very specifically, because signs in and of themselves, the miracles, which are called signs, John says are not the most important things for us to focus on. The miracle itself isn't the miracle. It's what that sign, who that sign points us to, that is important. Just in the same way when you're driving around the road and you see a yellow road sign, and you don't stare at the yellow road sign with a sharp curve on it while you drive off the cliff. You see the sign points you to something, and you pay attention to that. I was in Costa Rica, and you know, I took Spanish for a number of years, but I'm by no means fluent in Spanish. But they have these signs all over the place. Ten cuidado. And that means be careful or take caution, literally. And there'd be like falling rocks or a crocodile on the picture. Ten cuidado, you know. And so you always knew when you came up with those signs, hey, slow down. Something is coming. That sign is pointing us to. And so when Jesus turns water into wine at a wedding in Cana, and we say, oh, how could he do that? Or when he's in the boat, his disciples are freaking out because the wind and the waves are going and they think they're going to sink. And Jesus tells the wind and the waves to be quiet. And they stop. And there's this shock in the boat. Not that the wind and the waves stopped, but they turn around and look at Jesus and realize who's in the boat with them. The one whose words have control over creation. So when Jesus changes water into wine, well, John tells us in John chapter 1, verse 3, through him, Jesus, all things were made. Nothing was made that was not made through him. And so we see right away, well, of course, he's the one who has the power to change water into wine or to tell the wind and the waves to stop. He is the God of creation. Those signs are pointing to him as the one who has the power and the ability to do those things. When we get to chapters 11 and 12, we have really the pivot point, at least in John's telling of the story, where Jesus performs his greatest miracle outside of being raised himself, and he raises his friend Lazarus from the dead. Now, up until this point, Jesus really spent most of his time in the area of Galilee, which is a little bit of ways from Jerusalem, kind of his hometown area. And he's been preaching and teaching in that area. Well, he's caught the eye of the religious leaders in Jerusalem, and they're starting to become upset because Jesus is got a following and a gathering. And remember, I think we give these guys a hard time, and we should in some ways, but they were trying to protect the character of God. They thought Jesus was actually bringing people away from God. And they were the ones who were called to defend God and be the ones to share God with the people. And so they are starting to get upset, but Jesus has always been away. Well, Lazarus lives very close to Jerusalem. And so when Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, that is the final straw for the religious leaders in Jerusalem. It's when the high priest, Caiaphas, says he's got to go. And this is when they plot to kill him. As a matter of fact, Caiaphas says, it is better for one man to die than for an entire nation to collapse, to perish. And it's prophetic. Because one man, Jesus, is going to die for the nation, just not in the way that Caiaphas was planning. We have these seven I am statements, very famous. Jesus saying, I am the good shepherd, I am the way, the truth, and the life, I am the light of the world. And all of these are to bring us back, again, to link us back to the story of Moses in the burning bush, when God is telling him to go to the Pharaoh to deliver the people from Egypt. And he says, how are they going to believe me? Who should I say has sent me? God says, tell them, I am has sent you. So here Jesus is making very clear, again, statements about oneness with the Father, which is what's getting him in hot water with the religious leaders. Claiming to be God was a capital offense. And so where we're going to jump into the story today is in chapter 16, which is in the middle of these chapters 13 through 17, what we call the upper room discourse, or the Last Supper. Really what's happened is Jesus has said, okay, the time, my hour has come. And he rides triumphantly on a donkey into Jerusalem. The people wave palm branches, saying, Hosanna, Hosanna. And he gets his closest friends, his disciples, to go into an upper room. And Jesus prepares them for him to leave in this Last Supper, washing their feet, teaching them. And there really are two great themes that Jesus is focusing on this. He's talking to his disciples. He's talking to them. He says that there is a connection between the Father and I that enable everything that I'm doing. I'm not doing any of this on my own. Nothing that I've done is random. Everything that I'm doing because the Father has sent me to do these things. And the second thing he says is, you are going to be the ones who are going to continue this mission, but you're not going to be able to do it alone. You are going to have to be enabled by God in the same way that I am enabled by God. It will be the Spirit of God that teaches you, that reminds you of everything that I'm telling you, that helps you to understand, and that will lead you to continue the mission. Jesus says very clearly, John chapter 14, the words that I say to you, to his disciples, are not just mine, though. Rather, it is the Father living in me. He is the one doing the work. So he was in the Father was in him. And it would be the Holy Spirit, the counselor, that would lead his disciples in John chapter 17. Just as you, Father, are in me, the Son, I am in you. May they, the disciples, also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. That comes out of Jesus' prayer in John chapter 17, very end of this. So we're going to pick up our text here in John 16, verses 5 through 11. If you got your Bibles, go ahead and open it up there. I'm reading out of the NIV. Before we do, let's invite God and his Spirit to lead us in understanding and receiving the goodness of his word today. Father, it is a privilege to gather. It is a privilege to be called your children and to know you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, guide us with your Spirit today. Help us to people who receive your Spirit and allow your Spirit to be our guide in every single way. Allow us to be convicted, to be encouraged, to respond to you in repentance in the areas that we need to. Father, thank you for everyone here. I pray, Father, that you speak to each one of them in the way they need to hear from you today. I pray for this church, Father, that you will continue to bless it, that it will be a conduit of grace and mercy that gets to share shoeboxes at Christmas, gets to meet in women's ministries, gets to have youth group, regular fellowship time. Father, continue to bless them with new growth in their own lives, that they may draw closer to you. I pray all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Okay, Jesus, speaking to his disciples, says this, I tell you the truth. Verily, your translation might say, it is for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go away, the Counselor, the Helper, the Holy Spirit will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Now, there's an interesting paradox that's going on here, because Jesus is telling his disciples, look, I got to go. I'm going away, but I'm going to send the Spirit, and that's going to be good for you. And they're thinking to themselves, what are you talking about? You can't leave us. We've been following you for the last 3 years. We've left our homes, we don't have places to live, and they've been generally protected by Jesus for these last 3 years. But do they completely understand what Jesus is doing, even though they're with him? It's very clear that they don't. And yet, when the Spirit does come, they will. And so it is good that the Spirit comes, because the Spirit does help them to understand everything that Jesus was preparing them for. He continues, when he, the Spirit, comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. In regard to sin, because men do not believe in me. In regards to righteousness, because I'm going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And in regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. So Jesus is promising the giving of the Holy Spirit. And I think, you know, of all the things that we talk about in the Christian faith, the Holy Spirit is probably one of the most mysterious, one of the most difficult things to talk about, or not things, people to talk about. It's a subject that a lot of people just want to either not talk about or dance around, or we really get some wacky ideas about the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit is a unique, distinct person of the Trinity, of the Godhead. It's not an it, it is a he. He will come. And it's sometimes it's hard to make sense of, just even if you go back to this idea where God pulled the people out to Mount Sinai and he gives them the law, and you've got this idea of monotheism, one God, which would separate them from all of these other areas in religion that had many gods. And so we serve one God who is in three persons. Now, if you've studied any sort of Greek logic, which many of us were raised in this way of thinking, how can something be both three and one? It's hard to make sense of that. So we come up with kind of silly ideas. We talk about the Holy Spirit like he's an egg. He's got a shell and a yolk and a white. Or he's like water, which can be vapor and ice and also a liquid. And those, I mean, I get why people try and do that. But every one of those falls just so flat in trying to describe the God of the universe. He is so far beyond that. And then we talk about the Holy Spirit, and when we don't understand, sometimes we talk about him like he's the Force in Star Wars. He's out there somewhere. And if you just close your eyes, you can tap into him and have powers. Yes. He is a distinct person of the Godhead. He is not a source that is just out there somewhere. You know, and because he is so prominently talked about in the New Testament, we can often forget how much he shows up in the Old Testament. Right at the very beginning, Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. The Spirit of God was hovering over the waters when God brought chaos into order, right from the very beginning. We see the Spirit empowered Joseph to interpret dreams for Pharaoh. He gave wisdom to judges like Joshua and Gideon. He gave a spirit of knowledge to King David, and David regularly acknowledge a spiritual role in his life. 2 Samuel chapter 23, David says, "The Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. It was his word that was on my tongue." Now, when we get to the New Testament, we see stories like Luke's account of Jesus' baptism, chapter 3. It says this, "And as he," Jesus, "was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form, a dove." If you know the rest of that story, you know. And the Father says, "This is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." All three persons of the Godhead in the same place at the same time. Now, again, I'm talking about links. This language should be very familiar. The Spirit of God is hovering over Jesus, in the same way he was hovering in Genesis chapter 1. Jesus, we see in Luke chapter 4, he's led by the Spirit. He's filled with the Spirit in his great temptation. The apostles are filled with the Spirit in Acts chapter 2. Peter, Stephen, Barnabas, all to accomplish the mission God had for them, which was to testify to the truth of who Jesus was, who he said he was. Messiah. You know, if you do a simple word search for the word Spirit, and there are a few different words that we translate into the word Spirit, just in the 13 letters of Paul in the New Testament, shows up 149 times. Paul is big on the Spirit. The Greek word that's most often used in Paul's letters is the Greek word pneuma. It's where we get our English word, anybody?
Pneumatic.
Yes. Anybody, any other ones? How about this one? Pneumonia. That's not a good one. Don't get that. Go with pneumatic. Okay? But pneumonia is in our lungs, where our breath resides. Genesis chapter 2, God breathes life into Adam, into the man that he created. And at the very end of John's gospel in chapter 20, Jesus would breathe the Holy Spirit, new life, into his disciples. The word that he uses here is different than pneuma. It's only used once in the New Testament, in this case right here. However, it is the very same word that the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament, in Genesis chapter 2, where God breathing life, his Spirit, into man. All of those are connected on purpose. God breathing new life with his Spirit. Now, we're not going to go in much more detail just in the Holy Spirit. We could spend weeks doing this. I think just kind of coming up with a very simple definition of how the Spirit acts in our lives is where I want to move forward with. And Chelsea Knight, who's a crew, Campus Crusade for Christ staff member, writes this. I think it's very clear. She says that the Holy Spirit has many different roles, but the first thing to understand is that the Holy Spirit is given. Notice that. Not bought, not earned, not paid for. Given to people who believe in Jesus for the purpose of binding them together with God to help them become more like him. We use that word sanctification, becoming like Christ. The Holy Spirit is actively involved in our process of sanctification. She continues, the Holy Spirit is the presence of God in the life of the believer. Now we get to verse 8 of our text. Jesus says, when the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, comes, he's going to convict the world in three areas. In guilt, regards to sin, righteousness, and judgment. Now, those are all legal terms, convict, guilt, judgment. And so I think it's helpful in this context to think of the Holy Spirit as playing the role of an attorney. In the sense that but he gets to play both the prosecuting attorney and the defense attorney at the same time. He's the prosecuting attorney in that he brings the reality of our position with God because of sin before us. He says, here is the reality. You are separated from a holy God because of your sin. You cannot be in his presence. And you stand guilty as charged. And every one of us, if we're honest, would raise our hand and say, that is true. And yet he turns around and says, but the Father is gracious. And he has sent a Savior, his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, who through his life, his death, his resurrection and ascension to the Father has paid the price, the penalty for sin. And so you don't have to stand condemned in your guilt. You can receive God's forgiveness in his Son. And he will stand in the place between you and God on that day of judgment. He gets to play both roles. Now, you know, sometimes I think that we get caught up in thinking about God and only acting in supernatural ways. Like if God is going to do this amazing thing, then it's going to have to be a supernatural event. If that happens, he just pushes us out of the way and he says, okay, like roll up my sleeves and I'll step in and intervene and do this miraculous sign. Now, God, throughout the years, has done many miraculous signs, and he can act however he wants. But I think what we see more often in the scriptures is God acting through his Spirit in the lives of people. Not just moving us out of the way, but using us to be a blessing to other people. We see it right in the very beginning. He creates mankind, man and woman. He says, you are created in my image. Now, cultivate, create. What I made is good. Continue that process. Bear my image in this world. He uses Noah to help rebuild humanity after the flood. He uses Abraham to be a blessing to many, many people. And he used Moses to deliver the people. He didn't just come in and say, okay, I'll do it myself and release the people. He used Moses. So it makes perfect sense that God would continue in the same fashion to use his Spirit through the prophets, through Jesus, through the disciples, and through us as well, 2,000 years later. It's what we're doing this morning. We're celebrating the gift of God's word and the stories of these people that happened thousands of years ago. It's why Timothy tells us that all Scripture is God-breathed, God-spirited, useful for teaching, for correction. You know, how many times have you found yourself reading your Bible? And maybe it's something that you've read a number of times, but this time something stands out to you differently. Something just speaks to you in a different way than you've ever read before. And this is why I love reading a passage. And instead of, you know, I don't read large chunks of passage in a sitting very well. My mind starts to wander. I'd be much better reading a few verses for like a week and just letting them soak. Meditate. It's what I believe that King David was saying, right? Meditate on your word day and night. Your word has been hidden in my heart. It's this idea of just meditating. Yesterday, I was driving and I put Psalm 23 on my radio on repeat. I just want to listen to it over and over and over again. Because I want those words to sink in. I want the Holy Spirit to have an opportunity for me to let my guard down and to listen. And it's most definitely the work of the Holy Spirit to do that, to have those moments where you hear something differently in a way you've never heard it. And you say, gosh, Lord, I hear you. I need to stop withholding forgiveness from this person in my life. Or maybe I need to ask for forgiveness from somebody. I had an amazing opportunity with my dad, who's not a believer, yesterday. I've been praying for him. He had a falling out with my grandfather, and very tumultuous just family relationships. None of you have that, right? Yes. And my grandfather's a believer, but my dad is not. And so praying for them. And I got to see them yesterday, and to hear my dad had apologized. He had asked for forgiveness. My grandfather was a great answer to prayer and a great sign that those things can happen even in the lives of people that you're praying for that aren't believers. You know, the Spirit works through our testimony in the lives of people we love. He works through the testimony of the prophets, of the apostles. And God speaks to us. One of the reasons that I pray that God would speak to each one of you here in the way that you need to hear, because each one of us is in a different place right now. And the Spirit has the ability to do that, to know each one of our thoughts before we know. As if the Scripture tells us that the Spirit intercedes for us. We don't know what to pray, but the Spirit's there for us. I remember when I first started coming to church. I first came to church was this church. It wasn't this building though. And as I was close with the Dailies and Bob had been back in church for a long time, and I finally decided that the way I was living life wasn't working, and there might be a different way. And so I came, and Pastor Sam was preaching, and I don't remember what he said today, but I do remember that I was forced to face a reality that I was running away from for a long time. And when I continued, I went to church, I went to Sierra, and I remember for the first couple weeks I would kind of sneak in late and leave early, but it seemed as though the guy who was preaching, whether it was Dan or that was John, that they knew I was there. And that was really creepy. I didn't know either of them. And yet it seemed like they were talking directly to me. And I thought, this is uncomfortable. Now, later I look back and I think that uncomfort is good. I didn't understand it then. I didn't come back for a few weeks, and then I'd come back and then it would happen again. And I thought, I'm faced with the truth of something, that life is different than I have made it out to be, and I've got a decision to make. You know, that it took some time, but it was God's Spirit working in my life. Now, I don't share that story because I think it's unique to me. I think there are a number of us who've experienced that very same thing. Walking in here in a fellowship on Sunday morning, and you don't know, we don't know what's going on in your lives in the deepest ways, but God does, and He uses His Word. He uses us as preachers to encourage through the Word of God in what's going on in your lives. Now, there are three areas that I talked about here that Jesus really says is the work that the Holy Spirit is doing. He says He's going to convict the world of the sin of unbelief, of righteousness, and of judgment. And I just want to spend the rest of our time looking at those three things. So first of all, the Spirit convicts the world of the sin of unbelief. Now, the word that Jesus uses for convict here is a legal term. It's exposing someone to a set of facts through cross-examination. That's why I use the attorney role for the Holy Spirit. It really is the pronouncement of a legal verdict. It's not like, I feel guilty inside emotionally. It is, no, this is true about you. You are guilty of this specific act. And that's what was going on in my heart and mind when I was sitting in church over 20 years ago, listening to that. It wasn't that I just felt, you know, a random guilt inside of me. It was, if this is true, what he's saying, then I've got one of two choices. I can either put my hand in the sand and continue to hide, or I can walk into the light. I can have my sin exposed and forgiven. That's what John tells us in his third chapter of his book. This is the verdict, the conviction, the pronouncement of judgment. That light has come into the world, that people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. See, that was my decision. Many of you may have had that same choice, to either stay in the darkness or to walk into the light. See, Jesus coming into the world, his perfect life, his sacrifice, is a testimony to the guilt of all of us not being able to live that perfect life. And we have two choices. Believe in him, that he is the true Messiah, Savior of the world, or to reject him. That's the difference between belief and unbelief. Jesus never said he was a great moral teacher. The seven I am statements say, I am one with God. And so when the people hear the word of God preached or shared, they have the same option: to receive him in his fullness of who he is, or to reject him. Now, I think there's a good example of this in the second chapter of the book of Acts. And so this is after Peter has been given the Holy Spirit, and this is happening at Pentecost. It's 50 days after the Passover festival. There are a ton of people there, and Peter stands up to preach in a crowd because there are a number of people that are sharing this story of Jesus in languages that were different than what they originally knew. And these look like people who were not educated, but they're people from all over the nation there, and they're hearing this story of Jesus preached in their own language. And so they start responding, well, these guys must be drunk. And Peter says, it's 9 in the morning. Come on, guys. We have to be really good drunk to be 9 in the morning, right? So he starts off this famous, you know, sermon, and he says this. He says, therefore, let all Israel, he's talking to all, when he says that, I mean all Jewish people who've been called of God. Let all Israel be assured of this: God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Very clear statement of truth. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart, I think we could insert, they were convicted of their guilt. They were cut to the heart. And they said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? See, again, that's not like a child who just got caught lying or taking something that wasn't theirs. That is a child who is caught and realizes that they have made a mistake, and they need to own that mistake. So Peter replies, repent, turn around, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. There is a response to this truth. It's not just that you hear it, but that you respond to it. When you do, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. What's not said in that verse is how many people rejected Peter's preaching. So it's discouraging when our friends and family members reject the truth of God. It is the grace of God when we're able to receive it. Now, it's not as that Peter says something that's overly powerful or is this majestic speech. He just cuts right to the chase. This Jesus, whom you crucified, God has made the Savior of the world. The Spirit works through that in their hearts, helps them believe. The second thing he talks about here is he says that the Spirit convicts the world of righteousness. Jesus says that they're convicted of righteousness because, this is very important, this is not the same as being convicted of their sin. It is the conviction of righteousness because he is going to the Father. Now, what's unique about that? This is just so amazing. Jesus is going back to the Father is vindication for his entire ministry and life. Because he said, I came from the Father. And if he was not from the Father, he could not return to the Father. But because he's returning to the Father, it validates who he is and everything that he said as true. Because if you remember, Jesus was accused of a lot of things here on earth. He was accused of blasphemy, saying he was God, which is a capital offense. He was accused of being a glutton, of hanging out with sinners and tax collectors. He was even accused of being possessed by the devil. But we see the righteousness of God is vindicated in the life, the resurrection of Jesus, the Son of God, who sits at the right hand of the Father, the place of honor he deserves. And so God's righteousness that we desire is in the life of Jesus, not in the law anymore, or our spirituality, or our good works. It's in Jesus alone. Now he says, the Spirit will also convict the world of judgment. And this, you know, judgment is such a loaded word today. It has a very negative connotation to it. Nobody wants to be called judgmental. No one ever has. Self-righteousness has always been ugly. It doesn't matter how long it's been around. One of the things that Jesus went at the religious leaders most, he said, you guys are hypocrites. You're self-righteous. You've got a different standard for other people than you have for yourself. You keep these burdens on the people, and you yourself aren't even willing to lift a finger to help them. So self-righteousness here is ugly. But that's not, I think, exactly what Jesus is talking about, because he says here, it is the judgment of the prince of this world. It is the judgment of Satan. And notice he talks about this in past tense. He's not on the cross yet. So what does this mean? It means that through the life, death, the burial, resurrection of Jesus, that Satan and death has been defeated. The judgment of the one who had the power over death has been defeated. And so I like to think about this. When I read the Old Testament, I see judgment and justice almost used interchangeably when it's talking about God and his judgment. We talk about justice today, that's big, but we generally talk about justice in a subjective term, you know, not God's justice, but our justice, which is changing all the time, depending on whatever it is that we're mad at. And so that's hard to gauge, but God's justice is very clear. God's judgment is very clear. The Psalms are filled with it. Psalms 17, 26, 43 are filled with people crying out to God. God, bring your judgment upon our enemies. And when they say that, it's not like they're just saying, he's saying, smite these people. They're actually using that term to say, God, give us our day in court, where you are the judge and justice is given. How long, Lord, will you keep your eyes turned away from us? How long will you let our enemies overtake us? How long until we will get to have the judge of creation over all people? Sometimes God told him, you're experiencing judgment right now because of the decisions that you have made. See, we walk away from God, there are consequences. And the people did that. We do that, and we experience suffering because of it. And every time this happens to me, I'm thinking, oh, Jesus, just come back. I'm done. Can you come back, please? It would be good if you could just come back and all of this would go away. And then I remember how gracious God was with me, still is, but for 26 years before he called me one of his children. And I want to have that same grace for other people. I want to have that same idea that Peter does in 2 Peter when he says, the Lord's not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he's patient with you. Why? He doesn't want anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Every one of us, as friends or family members, that still need to know the grace of God. Every one of us knows people who are still trying to earn their way to God's grace on their own. So maybe instead of us praying for supernatural interference, maybe we can pray that God would use each one of us to be the people who bring that grace and mercy, that truth, into the lives of people we know. We don't have to be theological encyclopedias to do it either. We have to be available. I love when C.S. Lewis said, God doesn't need your good works, but your neighbor would like them. It's good for us to share what God has blessed us with. Or Peter in 1 Peter 3, he says this, always be prepared to give the answer for the reason, for the hope that you have, and to do so with kindness or gentleness and respect. Now, notice the beginning of that sentence. Always be prepared to give an answer when someone asks you. There's nothing wrong with preaching, with sharing that with people, but Peter says, be prepared to give an answer. And he didn't say a theological encyclopedia answer. He said, for the hope that you have. You know, I got to spend the afternoon with my 91-year-old grandmother yesterday, who is going to see the kingdom of God very soon. And it was hard to see her in the health that she's in right now, but she knows Jesus. And so in talking to her and praying with her, and getting to remind her that she's going to see the King. She's going to be free from the limitations of her body that's in pain right now. That's a good thing. That there is hope for her. That is much different than being at the bedside of someone who does not believe that Jesus is their Savior. So that hope, my hope does not come in the power of this world or wealth or pleasure. It comes in the righteousness Jesus Christ, my Savior. Getting to share that with my grandmother, maybe the last time that I get to see her, was a beautiful thing. She has that same hope. I want to close with this. You know the story of Moses and the people being led through the desert for 40 years. And amazing act of God when they were led by a pillar of smoke by day and a pillar of fire by night. And so when we get to Acts chapter 2 and Pentecost and the giving of the Holy Spirit, I don't think it's by mistake. It's very much by design that what we see are these flames that come on the people that is representing the Spirit of God that will now guide the people, not the pillar of fire anymore. It'll be the Spirit of God that guides the people in His Spirit. And so I pray that we would follow God's lead through listening and obeying the Holy Spirit as we read His Word, as we pray with one another, as we listen to correction and encouragement, that we commit to following Him. And knowing that sometimes the Spirit gets misrepresented. Sometimes people will come to me and they say, the Spirit caused me to do this crazy thing. And I generally respond with, whose Spirit? See, because John in a later letter tells us this, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. That tells me that there are false prophets, false spirits. God's Spirit will never ask us to do something that contradicts His character or His word. He will never lead us to cheat on our spouses or our taxes. He will never lead us to gossip about people or to withhold forgiveness. He will lead us to places that are uncomfortable. And that is a good sign that the Spirit is active and involved in your life. When you exercise, it's painful. You're breaking down muscle, but that builds up new muscle. The Spirit works the same way in our lives, in sometimes very uncomfortable ways, but it brings about new growth and a further trust and deepening dependency on God. And I pray every day that the Spirit would lead us, that we would listen to Him, that we would recognize how good it was that Jesus went, that He didn't leave us alone. He gave us His Spirit just in the same way He did His disciples. Follow Him. Let's pray. Father, what a gift it is to know Your Son, Jesus, as our Savior. Father, You have not left us alone, but You have given us Your Spirit to guide us. Help us to understand Your Word, to receive correction, encouragement, guidance. As the Spirit was involved in the creation of the world, in the new creation and the kingdom that Jesus ushered in His life, may we be people of God's kingdom that lived as though it were true. It were true that You, Lord, are seated at the right hand of the Father, place of honor, our King, our Savior. Father, help us to live free from the fear of death. Even though we will suffer in this life, we know that You have conquered sin and death. Satan has been judged. And Lord, we are people that will experience new creation, new life in You. So as we talk about our loved ones that pass, we can say with joy that they are experiencing new life, and new creation with our King, Jesus. In His name we pray. Amen. Have a wonderful Sunday.
Please stand.
I find my power at night.
Thank you.